Hello, welcome to a video production by our group, The Workaholics, on how the supply-side policies by the Singapore government has impacted our economy in recent years. We chose this question as we believe it has a wider scope to come up with ideas and also to improve our understanding of similar policies in actual case studies. In recent years, Singapore's economy has changed a lot. For example, it has shifted its industry from a tertiary one to a quaternary one, and it has welcomed its two new integrated resorts. These changes have prompted the Singapore government to come up with policies that aims to reduce the cost of production and to improve the efficiency of the industry. Singapore has also experienced a low level of productivity compared to other economies. As seen from the table, between the year 2000 and 2009, Singapore's growth in manufacturing productivity is a mere 0.7%. Before we proceed to the policies, we will clarify certain terms we may use in this video. Supply-side policies are policies which aim to improve cost of production, productivity, and efficiency by bringing change about employment, prices of goods, and services and income, which ultimately affects aggregate supply. Aggregate demand, or AD, is the total demand for final goods and services produced in a specific economy at various price levels, ceteris paribus, or provided all other variables remain constant. The aggregate supply, or AS, is the sum of the total output firms and companies are willing and able to supply at different price levels in any given time period. The gross domestic product, or GDP, is the total money value of final goods and services produced using resources within the country or economy in a given year. Structural unemployment is caused by workers not having a correct skill set for a specific job, causing the worker to be not able to find a job. The economic framework we will be using to illustrate the possible impacts of the policy is the ADAS framework, in which the AD and AS graphs intersect at the point highlighted to create an equilibrium level of national income, or GDP and general price level. This point represents the full employment level of national income, in which no further resources can be used. The two policies we will talk about is the Skills Program for Upgrading and Resilience, or SPUR, and the ways the government has come up with to develop the skills of the employees and innovation. Both policies aim to increase productivity by increasing the employment level.
Firstly, we will talk about SPUR. No, not the spikes you put at the back of your cowboy boots to make the horse go so fast you can almost fall off. Almost. But seriously, it's the Skills Program for Upgrading and Resilience. It is a funding support scheme initiated in 2009 by the Workforce Development Agency, or WDA. Its objectives are to cut costs, save jobs, to reduce the number of people retrenched, reskill and upskill by upgrading the skills of employees to prepare them for the current needs of industries, and finally, build capabilities for recovery to strengthen Singapore's manpower capabilities and to prepare Singapore for future upturns. It consists of four sub-policies aimed to help employees in three ways. Basically, the firms will send employees for skills upgrading to help increase the productivity of the firm. To encourage firms to do so, they will be given course fee subsidies and be compensated for the absence of their employees, or in short, be given absentee payroll. The skills the employees learn will be important for the firm in the near future. Let's now look how this will affect the economy. Due to the skills upgrading, resources are now better utilized. The total output of goods and services will increase, resulting in an increase in AS. The skills upgrading also solves the problem of structural unemployment. Therefore, firms are now able to retain their staff. Next, let's discuss how the Singapore government has done to develop skills and innovation. This begins with the setting up of the National Productivity and Continuing Education Council, or NPCEC, in 2010. It aims to boost productivity, encourage skills upgrading, and develop the Continuing Education and Training System, or CET. Overall, it hopes to turn Singapore into a productivity-led economy by focusing especially on certain niche sectors. Using Denmark as their case study, the government hopes to achieve the same results as them. Denmark increased their manufacturing productivity by 2.7% annually from 2000 to 2008 after the creation of a similar fund. The Singapore National Productivity Fund aims to support enterprises in all sectors, especially the niche ones. Of the $2 billion set aside, $1 billion has been put in, which will provide support for the next 5 years. The fund will also be used to develop a knowledge base for firms to propose productivity solutions. To sum it up, the government is giving money to companies so that they can improve the economy. Another initiative is the Workfare Training Support Scheme, or WTS. It aims to help workers with a lower set skill to stay relevant to the needs of the current society. Set up in 2010, it comprises three sub-policies. The first is to give employer grants and absentee payrolls for compensation to the firms. The second is to give awards to workers who have completed their training in its entirety. The last will be to provide lower skilled workers, especially those with secondary education and below, customized lessons to allow them to not miss out on upgrading opportunities. So what happens to the economy? There will be an increase in productivity across all industry sectors, increasing its productive capacity. AS will increase while bringing the prices of goods and services down and increasing national income, and hence reducing inflation. Overall, what have we learned from these case studies? We learned that the use of resources should be maximized for a resource-scarce economy like Singapore. Also, productivity is becoming the buzzword for the economy. Finally, to increase the resource pool of Singapore, there should be maintained competitiveness to attract foreign talent and investments. In conclusion, to improve a few resources economy, you need to make the old man at the railroad work at the office and earn more money for himself and the economy. Thank you for watching, and we hope it has improved your understanding on Singapore's supply side policies.